Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. As you probably know, we're studying the Sabbath School lessons for the first 3 months of 2014, January, February, and March. This particular series is entitled Discipleship, and this particular lesson, which is number 4 in that series, is entitled Discipling Children. That's an interesting idea. By the way, it's interesting, if you look in the dictionaries, you won't find the word discipling. Now, we know what discipling means, right? There is a word in Greek, but we don't have it in English. Anyway, discipling children. But before we begin, we'd like you to get your Bibles, have them handy, because we're going to look at some scriptures, and we hope that you will have a great time together. Let's begin with a word of prayer. A kind and wonderful Father, we bow before you, recognizing the privilege it is to worship and serve you. What a privilege it is to be your children. May we learn from our experience with our own children more about how we should relate to you as our Heavenly Father. And may we learn also ways to reach out to the children of this world and bring them nearer to you, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, the children are huge. In some societies, children are half the population. Now, here in North America, we've moved quite a ways away from that, and we're worried about having too many people who are elderly. But in some societies, it's still true that half the population are children. And what comes in your mind when we say discipling children?
Raising children.
Okay, right. Now, this is not disciplining children. This is discipling. And, okay?
Preparing them to go and share the gospel.
I hope everybody knows this famous passage in Matthew 18. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus asking, who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? So Jesus called a child, made him stand in front of them, and said, I assure you that unless you change and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Okay.
Now, what did he mean, become like children?
Now, you stole my question.
Okay. Oh.
What does it mean to become like children?
To be teachable.
Okay.
Open.
Are children more responsive to the gospel than adults?
Children are more responsive to learning.
Are they more gullible?
It could be.
Are they supposed to learn Christianity from their parents?
Yes.
Do children remember better than adults?
Absolutely.
Sometimes.
So sometimes, yeah.
Why do we... They remember the things they want to remember. Why do we seem to do a better job discipling children than we do discipling adults?
Because children have more of a clean slate. As adults, you have to kind of relearn things. Mm-hmm. Maybe a little harder.
Is the reason we do better with children is because we do such a lousy job with adults?
Well, we have more control over children.
Is that why we do better with when we evangelize them?
Do we do better when we evangelize children than adults?
Well, look around the church and ask people what percentage of those people have been Adventists since they were young. See if that gives you a clue.
Well, a lot of them will say, well, my mother and father are Adventists.
Yeah.
That's why we're...
Did they have the opportunity of rejecting it and going somewhere else?
Usually about college, that's where they get their opportunity.
Yes.
And many do,
yes.
Unfortunately.
Well, in ancient times, biblical times and earlier times, children had a very low status. I can remember when I first went to work in Africa. I worked in Africa for almost 17 years. When I first went to work in Africa in the 70s, 50% of the children died before they were 5 years old.
Wow.
50% of the children died before they were 5 years old. So there are some places in Africa where they, in the olden days, they didn't even give a child a name until he was a year old, for fear he would die. Mm. Incredible. Well, many of the cultures surrounding the Hebrew nation in biblical times actually offered children's religious sacrifices. You know, children come easy, easy come, easy go, right?
Yeah, I always thought that was so strange. If you want to offer God a sacrifice, you grab someone else and kill them. Mm-hmm. I mean, why don't you offer yourself as a sacrifice? I mean, that's just like bullying. I don't understand why that's a sacrifice, with you grab a small person that can't do anything. And how did that ever happen? That
it's kind of a pitiful sacrifice.
Who thought that up? That's, I know.
Because good question.
A lot of times they felt like the children had not sinned yet, like they were a better sacrifice. But it was all nonsense for their own self, for their own agenda.
Well, and some people would say, well, the ultimate sacrifice, if you're going to sacrifice the most precious thing to you, would be your child. So if you're trying to appease God's wrath, you give the very best thing you can give is your child. Mm. Well, talking about that, Manasseh, maybe the worst king in Israel's history, certainly the worst king in Judah's history, he actually offered his children as sacrifices. Read 2 Chronicles 33:6.
And he was Jewish?
Mm-hmm.
To what God?
Well, he probably thought he was offering it to Yahweh.
Think so?
I don't know for sure.
Because wasn't he a northern kingdom?
No, he was southern kingdom.
Was he southern?
Mm-hmm. Wow. Near the end of the southern kingdom.
That's the problem.
He sacrificed his sons in Hinnom Valley as burnt offerings.
Just outside of Jerusalem. Well, look at some verses now. How do you feel about this? And some people have made a big deal out of this in modern times. Children are a gift from the Lord. They are a real blessing. I remember asking one man who couldn't support the children he had in Africa, and he just kept having more. And I said, why do you keep having children? They're a gift from the Lord.
ways to not have them. But when you have nothing, and you have absolutely nothing, and you have a wife, all you have is sex. Yeah. Yeah, that's the only enjoyment you have. That's all you have.
Well, the sons a man has when he is young are like arrows in a soldier's hand. Happy is a man who has many such arrows. He will never be defeated when he meets his enemies in the place of judgment. So that means you're supposed to raise a whole army just by yourself?
Well, that's true for a farming economy. You have all sorts of children to go out there and help. And it's healthy for the children, and you're all working towards a goal. So I think children are a blessing.
Well, try Psalm 128, starting with verse 3. Your wife will be like a fruitful vine in your home, and your children will be like young olive trees round your table. A man who obeys the Lord will surely be blessed like this. May the Lord bless you from Zion. May you see Jerusalem prosper all the days of your life. May you live to see your grandchildren. I think that's a good idea.
You know, that's heart-wrenching, because what about people who can't have children?
Yeah.
And they're Christian and they just can't have children.
You get to enjoy somebody else's children.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's to Sarah.
I will have to tell you that I feel very blessed because we just have a new granddaughter. And I think Gordon is in that same category. Yeah, we're helping to repopulate the earth, I guess. But I can say that it's nice for us people of my age. Sometimes it's nice to be able to sort of hand them back to mom and dad. Well, we have a lot of verses here. We looked at a couple of them. Jeremiah 7:31, Deuteronomy. Let's look at Deuteronomy 6. That's a particularly significant one. Never forget these commands that I am giving you today. Now, this is Moses' first of three fairly lengthy speeches or sermons he made in Deuteronomy. And these are sermons he gave to the children of Israel just before they entered the Promised Land. And of course, he wasn't with them. He climbed Mount Pisgah and he died and was buried. God buried him, and 3 days later took him to heaven. So he says, never forget these commands that I'm giving you today. Teach them to your children. Repeat them when you're at home and when you're away, when you're resting and when you're working. Tie them on your arms and wear them on your foreheads as a reminder. Write them on the doorposts of your houses and on your gates. And if you visit Jerusalem, and if you visit, stay in one of the hotels there, or you go down to the western wall where the most holy site for the Jews, they will be happy. You give your arm out, they will be happy to wrap it up and round your head and do all these things, you know, literally.
Well, that's like God wrote in stone with his finger the word remember. Mm-hmm. I mean, how many ways can Moses and God say it?
Yeah. Well, there's a story, an interesting story I remember hearing one time about an evangelist who came home and told his wife that he felt like it was a successful day because 3.5 people had been baptized. And his wife looked, 3.5 people baptized? What do you mean 3.5 people? You mean 3 adults and a child? He said, no, 3 children and 1 adult, because the children will now live, hopefully, the rest of their lives, most of their lives as Christians. The adult's already gone through half his life or more. He only has half a life to live for Christ, mm-hmm. right? Well, there are terrible stories on the internet and among professionals about children who have been abused. It is really hard to believe that a parent or even any mature adult could do such a thing to a child. So what can we learn about childhood from its challenges and its challenges from the life of Jesus? Do you wish that you had some children around that were like Jesus? Well, how much do we know from the Bible about the life of Jesus, his childhood?
Not much.
Virtually nothing. We know about his birth and his eventually getting to Nazareth. We know about his visit to Jerusalem at age 12. And we know he started his ministry at age 27. Or 30, I'm sorry, he's beginning his ministry at age 30.
Well, you know, we think of childhood as a nice time, and we're thinking all these nice things about children. But, you know, it's a terrible, terrible rough time. A lot of challenges, a lot of peer pressure, a lot of situations. And to have a child grow up so they have their own personality, it's just, and Jesus must have felt that in his childhood. He was a good child, and often good children get picked on and stuff. I don't know. I just don't think it's a bed of roses childhood.
Yeah. There are two, what we have from the Bible about that whole thing is in Luke 2, verses 40 to 52, which just basically says Jesus grew 4 ways, physically, mentally, socially, and spiritually.
And are those the 4 ways we're supposed to help our children grow?
Yep. But there are 2 absolutely incredible chapters in Desire of Ages. One is page 68 to 74, and the other is page 84 to 92. One that's particularly potent is one called Days of Conflict. And it talks about things about where Jesus got his education, and how did he learn the Bible and all that. So look at these. I just picked out a few paragraphs. Among the Jews, the 12th year was a dividing line between childhood and youth. On completing this year, a Hebrew boy was called a son of the law and also a son of God. And we have suggested in the past that they were supposed to have learned
The
5 books of Moses by that time. He was given special opportunities for religious instruction and was expected to participate in the sacred feasts and observances. It was in accordance with this custom that Jesus in his boyhood made the Passover visit to Jerusalem.
Is it what we refer to now to where they go to the bar mitzvah?
Yeah, that's a bar mitzvah. The child Jesus, reading on and a little bit later, the child Jesus did not receive instruction in the synagogue schools, for his mother was his first human teacher. From her lips and from, that doesn't mean he didn't have any others, but she was the first one, right? From her lips and from the scrolls of the prophets, he learned of heavenly things. Now, that should make immediately something, big red flag pop up in your mind. Why?
Were there any scrolls of the prophets around?
Where would he have access to the scrolls of the prophets?
Only at the synagogue.
Only at the synagogue, probably. Do you think he had? Think it was possible for him and his mom to go down and look at the scrolls in the synagogue?
Aren't they handled only by...
I don't
by,
know. Oh. Well, or did she have them memorized? the very words which he himself had spoken to Moses for Israel, he was now taught at his mother's knee. Think about that. The very words which he himself had spoken to Moses for Israel, he was now taught at his mother's knee. Those would be the first five books, right?
Why do you suppose he didn't go to the schools?
Because he didn't want to learn their corruption.
Well, yeah, but there's nothing written down on instruction not to send him there. And why would their parents think that there was any corruption down there because everybody else is sending their kids there?
Well, I mean, God, I think, knew.
God knows, but I'm just trying to figure out why. Well, I think it would be just a sign that that he did have a connection with God. Yeah. Whereas if he did go to those schools, they would say, well, he must have been a good student. He probably would have been a good student.
Well, here's the next sentence is a challenging one. How do you understand this? As he advanced from childhood to youth, he did not seek the schools of the rabbis. Now, this is basically a repetition of what we've already said. He needed not the education to be obtained from such sources, for God was his instructor. Czar of Ages, page 70. What do you think that means?
God was his instructor. But why wouldn't anybody else do that also?
Okay. Previously, I mean, he studied about prayer, and he must have spent a lot of time in prayer, and it must have been part of his instruction time.
Yeah. Well, think of the implications of all that. What do they teach us about the humanity of Jesus? Well, heavenly beings. Another, a little bit later down, she said heavenly beings were his attendants. Does that mean that angels taught him?
Mm-hmm. It depends. I don't know what she means by that, because the Holy Spirit teaches people too, and mm-hmm. there's no manifestation of some body coming up to become your teacher. So it's kind of hard to know exactly what you should envision.
It says there, and the culture of holy thoughts and communings was his. From the first dawn of intelligence, he was constantly growing in spiritual grace and knowledge of truth. Desire of Ages, page 70, paragraph 3.
Well, like the angel came to Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. Mm-hmm. Of course, he had to prepare for his mission, and maybe these same angels helped him through childhood, maybe as he was in the forest, and mm-hmm. maybe he actually saw these angels. And
well, now let me read you the beginning of the next paragraph.
Oh, okay.
Every child may gain knowledge as Jesus did.
Okay.
Okay, now what does that mean? As we try to become acquainted with our Heavenly Father through his word, angels will draw near. Doesn't that imply that angels drew near to Jesus? Mm-hmm. Our minds will be strengthened, our characters will be elevated and refined, we shall become more like our Savior. And as we behold the beautiful and grand in nature, our affections go out after God. While the spirit is awed, the soul is, and that's not O-D-D, that's A-W-E-D, in awe, the soul is invigorated by coming in contact with the infinite through his works. Communion with God through prayer develops the mental and moral faculties, and the spiritual powers strengthen as we cultivate thoughts upon spiritual things. That's the next paragraph.
So if she's saying prayer makes us stronger, mm-hmm. and when we're reading the Bible, angels draw near us and somehow give us something?
Yeah, that's what it sounds like, doesn't it?
It may be that it wasn't just that Mary taught him. Mm-hmm. Maybe she provided the environment, the perfect environment for him that he may learn from. Because our children don't have that type of environment. There's so many things going on. We don't have that perfect environment for.
We don't have time to listen to God.
No, and we don't have our children don't have the environment to really be still and expect angels to teach them and really learn the way they should.
Well, we know that some of Christ's most remarkable miracles involve children. Can you think of some?
Samuel
raising Jairus's daughter.
Raising Jairus's daughter.
The feeding of the 10,000.
Involved children, yes. What about raising the widow of Nain's son? What about healing the epileptic child at the foot of the Mount of Transfiguration? What about healing the son of that man who came from Capernaum, the nobleman? Some really remarkable miracles happened. And think about it, you know, we're so used to things, we pull a cell phone out of our pocket and we call around the world and we don't think anything of it. Nobody in Jesus' day had even heard of anything like that. And Jesus said, okay, your son 20 miles or 30 miles away will be healed. Huh? What kind of influence do you have on something 30 miles away? You thought about that?
But the man knew.
Man believed it.
The man even knew that Jesus could do that.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to take just a second and show you something very interesting. Open your Bibles, if you have them handy, to Luke 8, the first three verses. Luke 8, verses 1 to 3. Sometime later, Jesus traveled to towns and villages preaching the good news about the kingdom of God. The 12 disciples went with him, and that's we always just assume it's Jesus and 12 disciples, right? And so did some women. Whoa. Who had been, I mean, you know, what's going on here? I mean, what happened at nighttime? Was there always a village around, or were they out there sleeping in the fields? And so did some women who had been healed of evil spirits and diseases. Mary, who was called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had been driven out. Joanna, whose husband Chusa was an officer in Herod's court, and Susanna and many other women who used their own resources to help Jesus and his disciples. Who's supporting Jesus and his disciples?
The women.
The women. And there's some hint that this Joanna, whose husband Chusa was an officer in Herod's court, Chusa was the one who came to Jesus and got his son healed, and that's why Joanna is following Jesus.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
It's something that he's actually letting women follow him.
Yeah.
At that point.
Exactly. So each of these parents, and of course, we mentioned the story of the woman up in the area of Sidon, Tyre and Sidon. And Jesus took his disciples all the way up there. He spent quite a long time walking all the way over there just to heal that woman
and
that child.
What was a woman or a child?
Well, it was a woman who came and sought Jesus' help, but it was a child that was healed.
What was the child healed of?
The child was healed of demon possession. At least that's what we're told. It was mm-hmm. demon possession. Mm-hmm. How do you suppose, what do you think the parents said to those children later as they grew up about Jesus?
Probably told them the story, that's for sure.
Plenty of times. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But there's a part of that story that could be pretty troubling. If Jesus so lovingly healed those children, why didn't, or even now doesn't, heal our children or heal other children even today? I mean, you know, we have a hospital full of children over here not far from us. What would happen if Jesus sort of walked through and healed everybody in the whole hospital?
Economic turmoil.
I think about that also because there are so many children around the world. They're street children, don't even have parents, mm-hmm. and their lives are horrible. And often I think, you know, like, God, do something for mm-hmm. the least of these.
Yeah. Well, wow. This goes back to that we're in a sinful world, mm-hmm. and something is happening here. And I don't know if we want to go into it, but we're in a sinful world.
Yep.
You know, there's one time, the place that I witnessed so many miracles, the one place was when I was helping out in Pathfinders. I couldn't believe what those kids would pray for. Mm-hmm. There was one time that the little girl went out in this big old field, lost a little key, and she was crying about it. For, you know, she lost this key, and some of the kids came together and said, why don't we just pray and we'll go out and look for it? I mean, what would you think? What would you think when they did that? They were just so innocent, you know, and I said, oh man, if they pray and they don't find it, this is gonna, they're gonna remember that for the rest of their life. They prayed, they went out there, I couldn't believe it. They found it. They found it. And then there was a time when the bus wanted to go to Canada, you know, to go through, because they wanted to go to Canada, but they wouldn't let us go because we didn't have slips or something that we couldn't go. And there was five buses there, and a bunch of kids said, let's just pray about it. Let's just pray about it. So what do you think when these guys are praying about it? And the bus driver says, listen, we can't just leave. And then after a while, the other four buses left, but our group still wanted to pray, and so the bus driver kept saying, well, let's just wait until they say, okay, let's turn around. And sure enough, they let us through. And it was just pretty incredible. And I always thought, you know, is it because we're not children that we don't, you know, get this thing?
Wow.
But I think really that the opportunity right then was very fragile, and you know, God had to respond to these prayers, because it would affect them for the rest of their life if it didn't happen. And so it's just pretty incredible. So work with pathfinders, and if you get a group that can that wants to pray, you'll really see some miracles.
That's amazing.
Another thing that we know about children is they have lots of energy. Mm-hmm. I had an older adult just recently say, "Man, why can't God figure out how to give that kind of energy to us?" But they also, some of them especially, need constant care and attention. And is that supposed to be, I mean, is that part of what we're supposed to be when we're like children? And now, another aspect, you've heard probably somebody say this, but let me say it to you again. The most important sermon children will ever hear is not the one the pastor preaches, but the ones their parents live. The most important sermon children will ever hear is not the one the pastor preaches, but the one their parents live.
In school, we were having a suspension meeting for a student who couldn't quit cussing in school. And so we all sat there, and his parents came in for the meeting. The minute they walked in the door, they were cussing. And we just thought, oh, wow, you know.
It is something, because they do watch. Even when parents kind of hide what they're doing, they know it. Mm-hmm. And then that little hidden thing kind of transfers to them as they grow up. Mm-hmm. It is something else.
So how do children respond to Jesus?
They were drawn to him.
Trusting.
Look at Steps to Christ, page 11, paragraph 2. Even little children were attracted to him. They loved to climb upon his knees and gaze into the pensive face, benignant with love. So there were apparently times when Jesus is sitting, they sat down to preach, and children were climbing on his lap, sitting there and in just enjoying his presence as he's preaching to the crowds. And then there's one that's even more remarkable. That's found in volume 3 of the Testimonies, page 422, first paragraph. The poorest and humblest were not afraid to approach him. Even little children were attracted to him. They loved to climb upon his lap and to kiss that pensive face benignant with love. I don't know if they were trying to kiss him while he was trying to talk. I hope not.
Now, is it our duty in discipling children to make Sabbath interesting, mm-hmm. fun, a learning experience, to make church interesting?
We should do that.
And it helps when you have figured out how to make it interesting for yourself, because then you can do some transfers to their situation.
Think about the society that you know of, what you know of the society in Jesus' day. Now think about yourself as a child. How do you think you would have responded to the Pharisees, or the Sadducees, or the scribes?
What do you mean?
Think about what you know about Pharisees, and then think about what you know about you as a child, and try to put the two together.
Did the children have anything to do with the Pharisees and scribes?
Generally not.
I mean, should
why not?
So are you saying what's the difference?
No, I'm saying, how do you think children, I mean, we're trying to get a picture of Jesus and how Jesus responded in this context. So I'm saying, how do you think children responded to the other authority figures in their day?
I think they were scared of them.
Yeah.
We should bring it to our day. How do children respond to adults in the church today?
Yeah.
Can they run up to the pastor and give him a hug?
I hope so.
It depends on the pastor. I've seen pastors that the children just almost knock them down. Mm-hmm. But I've seen other pastors that are not approachable, so the children just look at them. Mm-hmm. It depends on the person.
Depends on the child, too.
Yeah. Some children don't care.
Well, some of them are pretty shy, and everybody.
Yeah.
Another quotation. I hope you won't mind my bringing another quotation. In the children who are brought in contact with him, Jesus saw the men and women who should be heirs of his grace and subjects of his kingdom, and some of whom would become martyrs for his sake.
Wow.
Think about that. He knew that these children would listen to him and accept him as their redeemer far more readily than would grown-up people, many of whom were the worldly, wise, and hard-hearted. In his teaching, he came down to their level. He, the majesty of heaven, did not disdain to answer their questions, simplify his important lessons to meet their childish understanding. He planted in their minds the seeds of truth, which in after years would spring up and bear fruit unto eternal life. Desire of Ages, 512 to 515. And there's a picture in there in the middle, so it's 515 immediately follows 512. And yet we know, by contrast, that in our world there are so many children suffering because of abuse they have experienced from a trusted adult. Some estimates suggest that up to 40% of girls and 20% of boys have experienced some kind of sexual abuse as children. What does that say to you?
Terrifying. That's why I decided after my marriage, you know, I was divorced in 2002. Even before that, in 1999, when we separated, my ex-husband and I decided I was going to stay alone and just watch my children.
Yeah.
Because you hear so many things, it's terrifying.
Well, not only from adults, but now we have the TV, the internet, and, I mean, the children are being abused through...
Yeah.
Well, when they're taught that they just evolved from some primordial ooze, that there is no God, isn't that abuse?
Mm-hmm. Yes, it is.
I mean, that's probably the greatest abuse you could, and that's the national religion, is evolution.
Earlier, we suggested that most Christians become Christians at a relatively young age. Why do you think that's true? Mm-hmm. We've talked about it now, some different aspects of it.
Well, children become Christians at a young age when they're born into Christian families.
Mm-hmm.
But for children who are not born into Christian families, I think the majority of them become Christians when they get older and they get outside the influence of their families. So I don't know what kind of statistics. I mean, if you're born in a Christian family, of course you're going to have more children. Sometimes people use that to throw out, oh, I can't talk to an adult about religion. If you haven't been in a Christian family, when are you supposed to become a Christian? You can't become a Christian when you're a child. So that's when you should start talking to people after they have moved away from their family.
Okay. Ellen White comments like this. It is still true that children are the most susceptible to the teaching of the gospel. Their hearts are open to divine influences and strong to retain the lessons received. The little children may be Christians, having an experience in accordance with their years. They need to be educated in spiritual things, and parents should give them every advantage that they may form characters after the similitude of the character of Christ. And let me interrupt here for just a second. Let me ask you a question. I can remember people who were old enough almost to be my parents' parents that said they expected Jesus to come in their day. And then the next generation, they expected Jesus to come in their day. But I don't know. I mean, I look around me and I say, man, how can this world survive like this much longer? Really. And I'm wondering, is it appropriate for us to say to the young children in our generation, Jesus is going to come in your day? Or is that presumption?
It's a possibility, and that's what Jesus said. No one knows the hour of the time, so we need to tell them the truth. So
well, would you rather be like a Boy Scout, be prepared?
Yeah.
Or would you want your head in the sand like the ostrich?
Yeah.
So like the Scouts say, always be prepared. What's the matter with being prepared?
But you can't scare.
Be square.
Scaring them into heaven, or like this statement says, chase heaven to avoid hell, is kind of a... Mm-hmm.
Well, no, I don't think you can scare people. I hope you're not trying to scare people into heaven. I think you need to. I mean, when a kid can hardly see anything in front of his face except an iPad or an iPod in his ears or a TV or something like that, and that's the only thing you think about, would it be appropriate to say, oh, by the way, have you thought about the fact that Jesus might come while you're still alive?
But some
I think it's very appropriate, but it's just, and especially in today's market with schools having taught kids that there is no God, or you just believe and have faith. And I had a conversation with a fellow last Friday, and we have faith. Well, it's your faith. Well, and there's no quick pat answer. But you got, if you can somehow pique their interest, to get in there and start looking in the book.
Mm-hmm. Many of them have the Bible. My son has the Bible. He has some Ellen White things. He has gospel music, and he goes through all of it. I think some children, I can't explain it, have a love for God. Mm-hmm. I have, like, my son and my daughter, Ashley. Ashley, they were both raised the same way. At a certain age, Ashley started questioning everything. My son never questioned God. My son sometimes questioned people, and he never said anything really bad about people, but he'll say, but my son never ever wavers about God. He doesn't understand it all, but he believes, and sometimes I'm like, oh my God, how did I get this kid?
We're very, very lucky as Adventists because we have a big picture. Mm-hmm. And I know my nephew, who's not an Adventist, likes Doug Batchelor, and he has learned the big picture by listening. And he says that he can see Jesus is coming soon, and it gives him a comfort, and it gives him a context to put what's happening in the world so he's not so confused. Mm-hmm. And I think it gives him strength, and he even talks to his friends who are maybe just out of rehab, or, I mean, he's got a group of friends, like, you know. But anyway, it gives him a perspective that gives him strength. Mm-hmm. We don't realize what we have in the great controversy theme.
Reading on, took a little break now. Fathers and mothers should look upon their children as younger members of the Lord's family, committed to them to educate for heaven. The lessons that we ourselves learn from Christ, we should give to our children, as the young minds can receive them, little by little opening to them the beauty of the principles of heaven.
You know what that says? You better be prepared to be a parent. I mean, you have to ask God for help, because you can't help your kid if you are not up with things.
So how well are we doing with our young people in the church these days? I think this is probably still true. I heard one pastor say that if we kept all of our own children in the church, our church would be going faster than it is with all of our evangelism. I mean, if we just forgot all evangelism completely and just kept our own children in the church, we would be growing faster than if...
Well, God couldn't keep all the angels in heaven.
Yeah.
I mean, freedom of choice. We can try and try and try.
Why do adults become more cynical and skeptical about religion?
Because they look at Christians. Because a lot of time we measure Christianity by what we see someone else who with the title Christian doing. Mm-hmm. And we should apply the same thing to ourselves, because we're all hypocrites to some degree. We all say something and may do something else.
I don't have the exact words, but Gandhi once said something like this. He says, "I admire your Jesus. It's just I don't see him, his example in your church very often."
Well, we're supposed to do things in an orderly way, and just what's happening in our church. I mean, we're like rebelling. And that's, didn't Ellen White said that when the church starts to shake, a lot of people would be lost just because of the bad witness that, and I mean, and there's so much criticism. Yeah. If a new person looks up Seventh-day Adventists on the internet and gets on some of these sites, you know, what are we doing to ourselves?
Would it be possible for an Adventist church to organize itself in such a way as to be attractive to children? Now, let's be honest. We know that the young people sometimes get carried away with bizarre fashions.
Well, what age children are you talking about?
Any age. Take your pick.
Because there's those animal shows, and they bring those wild creatures. That's very attractive
to
kids.
Okay, yeah, it's true. Yeah. And some adults.
There's a news station, Christian station, geared solely to children, 24 hours. You just have to call your provider and ask that they provide it. It's called Jesus Christ Youth something. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And you know, just because it's loud, the music and stuff, doesn't mean all the kids like it. Mm. Where I taught in school, to tame the hungry beast or whatever, the school would bring in rock bands at lunch or something. I would have more kids come into the room because it hurt their ears. They didn't want any part of it. Sometimes we think we know what kids want, but we should ask them what they want.
Well, but we recognize that the youth of today have unusual, by our standards, unusual music tastes. And sometimes they behave in very strange ways. Does your church need to become more energetic and more able to attract vigorous young people? Is it possible to adapt the taste to the tastes and needs of young people without sacrificing the truths that made us what we are as a church?
There's different young people. You go to GYC and they're playing violins. You go to another place and they have, in my community, they have drums. I mean, so you can't put young people in one bucket.
Well, you can't put young people in with old people too sometimes, because older people like to worship a certain way and it just doesn't go well with the young people, and you've got to accommodate that somehow.
Yeah.
And so.
Okay. Well, our church, you know, here at Loma Linda, has taken some major steps to try to provide special services that are unusual just for young people. Is that a good idea?
What do you mean by unusual?
Well, it's not what the typical Adventist church does.
No, it's not. It's I would put it that it's typically not what that generation did.
What generation? You mean the generation before them?
Yeah, because there's my parents' way of worshiping. I didn't really like it either. Mm-hmm. You know, I had to come up with the new way that kind of I related to. And I know that you just have to stay open for the ones under you now that come up.
There's a bit of, There's a bit of, I don't want to say hypocrisy there, but Adventists in North America worship one way. When you go to Africa, Adventists in Africa, they worship. The worship may be something you might like, whoa, wow. But other people laud it, like, oh, we're getting more people baptized. It's great. Because we have to be even. Adventist is Adventist or it isn't. And we have to accept that children might need something a little different than what older people may need. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. How did you respond to the church services and so forth when you were a child?
Sometimes they were boring.
And long.
And sometimes they weren't.
Yeah.
They seem special. They seem special. The organ, you never heard an organ, and it was a special place to be.
Okay.
Well, I don't know. My grandma helped me out by putting words on a sheet of paper, and every time we heard that word in a sermon, we would put a mark on it. Mm-hmm. And we'd do that all the way down, and that kind of kept our interest up, but I couldn't tell you what the sermon was about, but I can tell you how many of these words, like work and whatever, they were used.
What a smart lady. Smart lady.
There are a lot of children in our Adventist churches. Not all of them are going to grow to become adults or have children of their own. But every one of us has been a child at some time. Can you remember what it was like to be a child?
I do. Adventist child.
Are you excited about going to church every Sabbath?
When I don't go to church, I don't feel good during the week. And I don't. I have had people tell me, why do you go? I say, I've never missed church. I may go see other things and listen to other things. I try not to miss church. And there was a time when I used to go to church on Saturday and Sunday because I couldn't get enough of church for some reason.
Make sure you're covered.
Oh, yeah.
Our family did not go to church. And so once, twice a year, Easter or whatever, my mom would dress us up and send us off to walk down the block to the community congregational. And one summer she put us in Sunday school. And I still have the diploma from fifth grade to sixth grade. And so church for children who are not brought up in church is a very special place. I remember when they were doing communion, it was almost like I was in awe. What is going on? And so it's a different experience for a child who doesn't go to church versus one that has gone to church since they have been in diapers.
Certainly, certainly. Yeah. Well, we don't tie things around our arms and around our heads anymore. What does that mean? What's that supposed to mean for us?
Tie things around.
What do you mean, tie the
phylacteries?
The commandments?
Mm-hmm.
We're always supposed to keep it in our mind, always supposed to think about it in all that we do. Think about God's word.
You know, the Jews showed some pretty remarkable insights. Let me give you an example. If you go to a real Jewish hotel, outside of every room, there'll be a little 45-degree angle, a little device. What's in that, do you know?
I've never been to a Jewish motel that had that.
It's a little bit of scripture.
Yeah.
It's a little bit of scripture. And why do you suppose it's at 45 degrees?
Mm-hmm. A tablet.
Tell us, we can never guess.
I know.
Well, if it's vertical, that implies that the only thing you need to relate to is God. If it's horizontal, the only thing you need to relate to is other human beings. So 45 degrees, it says, if you're a good Jew, you need to relate to God and to other people.
And they kept it there as a sign to remind them. Mm-hmm. That was good. Maybe we need to put it on our forehead and on our wrist these days.
Do we always act as if we recognize the fact that if we are adults and a child is present, in effect, we're acting as a mentor? I mean, basically, do we recognize when children are around, they're watching us?
Yes.
When they start doing what we do, we realize that.
And maybe that's a little too late.
You know, I had a guy at, when I lived in, my wife and I were going to MSU, Montana mm-hmm. State University. Mm-hmm. There was a guy next to us that swore. I mean, he was from the Navy, mm-hmm. and anyway, he swore every other word. You know, there was some language, but it was almost like poetry. He did it so. But anyway, there was a little on the next door. There was another family with a little girl, and she, after a while, she started using some of those words, and he heard her, and he cleaned up his language just like that.
Very good.
I mean, it was he just knew it was happening, and he cleaned it up.
He hurt himself.
Yeah, he hurt himself there, and I thought it was pretty
coming
amazing
out of
a because
little girl.
People, you know, they have a hard time trying to get rid of that kind of language, but man, he just did it real quick. It was pretty incredible.
Okay, now it's time to sort of wrap up. What do you think Jesus had specifically in mind when he said you must become like little children?
Teachable,
mind open.
Okay.
Willing to grow.
What is the most important characteristic of a child?
You know, a child trusts. Okay. They trust you.
Okay, but that's the part of it. What?
I say the capacity for growth.
The capacity for growth, of course. Now, if a child fails to grow physically, what do?
Take him to the doctor.
We become concerned. If he fails to grow mentally, we become totally alarmed, right? And are we supposed to, if he fails to grow spiritually, are we supposed to say, that's nice?
Mm-hmm. No.
There's a couple of passages we need to look at just briefly. Look at Hebrews 5:11-6:3. This is probably Paul was the author of Hebrews. We don't know that for sure, but probably. There is much we have to say about this matter, but it is hard to explain to you because you are so slow to understand. There's been enough time for you to be teachers, yet you still need someone to teach you the first lessons of God's message. Does that sound like he's talking to children?
No. Stubborn adults.
Instead of eating solid food, you still have to drink milk. Anyone who has to drink milk is still a child without any experience in the matter of right and wrong. Does that sound like he's praising children? Solid food, on the other hand, is for adults who through practice are able to distinguish between good and evil. Let us go forward then to mature teaching and leave behind us the first lessons of the Christian message. We should not lay again the foundation of turning away from useless works and believing in God, or the teaching about baptisms and the laying out of hands, or the resurrection of the dead, or even eternal judgment. Let us go forward, and this is what we will do if God allows. Does that sound like he's all hep on being a child?
I don't think he's saying anything wrong about being a child, but he's just basically saying, when I was a child, I did as a child. Yeah. You're supposed to, and when you become an adult, you should do as such.
But another thing is that the illustrations do fall short sometimes. Yeah. They're not completely accurate. I mean, you can't take them clear to the end on everything.
Well, look at Ephesians 4, starting with verse 13. And so we shall all come together to that oneness in our faith and in our knowledge of the Son of God. We shall become mature people, reaching to the very height of Christ's full stature. Then we shall no longer be children, carried by the waves and blown about by every shifting wind of the teaching of deceitful people who lead others into error by the tricks they invent. Instead, by speaking the truth in a spirit of love, we must grow up in every way to Christ, who is the head. Under his control, all the different parts of the body fit together, and the whole body is held together by every joint with which it is provided. So when each separate part works as it should, the whole body grows and builds itself up through love. Does it sound like he's talking about maturity and growing up? So when do we need to be children, and when do we need to grow up?
That's a good question. Are you going to answer it?
What were the temptations you faced? You struggled with really when you were a child? Now you don't have to answer that out loud.
Cookie jars.
My mouth.
Is it possible during a few hours in the Sabbath that we can have so much influence on a child that it overrules everything he does all the rest of the week? Or do we need to think about things we can do with children during the week?
During the week.
All the time.
What do you make of the famous passage in Proverbs 22:6? Teach children how they should live, and they will remember it all their lives. Well, you know, the King James says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will what?
Not depart
from it. Is that true?
Didn't God do a perfect job with the third of the angels and Lucifer in heaven.
Oh. Yeah.
And yet look where they ended up.
Mm-hmm. But I believe in some ways true. Because you may go away from it, but you tend to come back a little. You're not the same as someone who's never heard it.
Yeah. Well, but think a moment. Proverbs are what? They're not promises, they're proverbs. What's a proverb? A proverb is a description of how things usually work.
That's right.
See, it's an aphorism. Okay. Does your church have a plan for discipling children?
Yes.
Have you been a part of that plan?
No.
You think it's always somebody else's responsibility? And another question, just some things to think about as we close our time here. Are you more comfortable in relating to children of a certain age? And if so, why do you prefer that age? I have a couple of granddaughters now, a brand new one and one that's about 2.5, and she is, I know some people say talk about the terrible twos, but she's a delight. She really is fun.
Well, it's they fun. Always...
My wife... She liked our kids when they were little, but I liked them when they're bigger. I thought they were more interesting. But
yeah, exactly. Well, is it possible for conservative adult Seventh-day Adventists to relax and have fun with children?
Why not?
Can we learn to be spontaneous and imaginative?
Jesus was a conservative Seventh-day Adventist, and yes. He certainly relaxed and had fun with kids.
Yeah.
So...
Jesus was everybody's uh-huh. Jesus.
Can we learn to play games with children that they enjoy? Or do they always have to conform themselves to what we want to do? Remember that those children that you might be having fun with right now will one day be the responsible adults leading the church. Mm-hmm. Are we really preparing our children for that? How would we do that? What do we need to do to prepare children to be the future leaders of the church? And again, the question that I asked earlier, would it be a good idea to say to our children, you know, it's very likely that you're going to look up one day and see the Jesus coming in the clouds? Think about that. You try to answer it for yourself. See you next week.